All right, folks. Well, like it or not, we are in the national spotlight. And the truth is that this is a huge opportunity for the city of Baltimore if we're willing to take it. But because it, for many of you and for myself included, it seems like this has been an ongoing saga now between the president and the media and Elijah Cummings and everyone else that is jumping in, you might forget that all of this began just several days ago, less than a week ago, on a Saturday morning. And shortly after, or shortly before the president started tweeting, there was a report on Fox News by Kimberly Klasick of here, Baltimore County. And we're joined now by Kimberly Klasick to discuss this report that she did. Kimberly, so first question, what made you do the report?
Great question. Hello to you. Thanks for having me, by the way. So I was watching ABC Politics, the show that comes on Sunday, about 2 weeks ago. And on that show, Congressman Elijah Cummings said that his constituents told him that they were afraid of President Trump. And I thought, how could that be true in an area, especially, I'm not saying, you know, I know there's other parts of his district that are nicer. But I know West Baltimore, you know, the crime and the shootings and even the non-fatal shootings are through the roof. And I thought, how could they possibly be sitting around thinking about Trump? I just don't believe it. So I didn't want to assume. I wanted to go out there and kind of ask around just to see if that is the case. So I took my little Sony camera and I went into West Baltimore and I saw two gentlemen sitting on a stoop. And I got out of my car and I asked, you know, I just have a couple questions, if you don't mind. And the one guy said, sure, what's up? I said, Congressman Elijah Cummings said that his constituents are afraid, are Trump. You know, how do you feel about that? And they started laughing. And the one gentleman said, if you want to know what we're afraid of, I can show you something really scary. Now, I don't suggest anyone at home do this, but I said, okay, show me. So he actually jumped in my car. I know this is poor decision on my part, but I felt like this was a good thing. He jumped in my car. We went two blocks, I guess you could say two blocks east from where we were, and into onto the street that he lived on, and he showed me an abandoned row home next to the home that he and his wife shared. And he said, you could go in if you want to. He said, but I can show you right here, and this is, I don't know if everyone's seen the video, but there's a video of me going through. Yeah, okay, there's a video of me going through, and there's trash on the side of this abandoned home in an alleyway. And so then I actually put the video into that yard of the abandoned home, and he was telling me how they actually, as a community on the street, moved that trash from the alleyway into that abandoned home's yard because they didn't know what else to do. So I found out they had called the city multiple times, 311, I guess is the number they called. And they told me that that trash hadn't been picked up in that area since December of 2018.
Wow.
So that's how long it's been sitting there. Yeah, and it was amazing. So we then went into the abandoned home. He checked it out first, came back out and said, hey, it's good to go if you want to go in. I said, sure, why not? So we went in and I saw basically where there were a lot of, must have been addicts, homeless addicts had been staying. And he said, you know, that goes on, you know, 7 days a week, there's always people going in and out of there. And he said, unfortunately, that's where they stay and take shelter. He believes there's, you know, an even larger homeless problem in that neighborhood now. But that's how it all started, I guess you could say.
Wow. And Kimberly, can you tell me, did you see any children while you were there?
Yeah. So actually, one of the women that I talked to, she was there with her daughter. And they were a little, I guess you could say, not on the stoop, but a little further down from where they lived in that home. But in that very next home on the other side, not where even where I was, that house was also abandoned and boarded up. So it's, I mean, on that block alone, there are, they said, six livable row homes. And I would say there's probably about 20, 22 row homes on that block.
Wow.
So, on both sides. Yeah.
Wow. So since you that video aired on Fox News, I know that you've been inundated with media attention. Are you surprised by the response that you've gotten?
I'm a little bit surprised because I honestly thought I was doing a good thing. You know, there was a lot of people that are behind me and support it, mostly the residents. But then you have people in the media and, of course, those on city council and others that are upset about it and said I brought shame to Baltimore. And I thought, you know what? This guy asked me if I could post about it because they're really concerned with it. They're not getting any answers. They want something done. And I told him at that time I had 16,000 followers on Twitter. I had spoken to Council President Brand Scott multiple times. He's actually helped me in the past get school uniforms for a couple kids that didn't have them. I said, so maybe this will get some attention from local officials and we can get this trash out of here. I had no idea that the president would be watching Fox and Friends that morning.
So Senator Bernie Sanders said something that was pretty poignant not so very long ago, in which he referred to Northwest Baltimore as looking like a third world country. Why do you think, or do you believe that that was very different from what you showed? And if not, then why do you think the response to him has been different than it was to you?
You know what? I don't know. I don't want to say it's because I'm conservative or if I'm pro-Trump. I mean, that's what it seems, you know, but I haven't really asked anybody that that's the case. But, you know, he's absolutely right. I don't think people realize what I showed on my videos doesn't even give you the whole scope of what it really looks like. And to me, I just feel like, it, you know, it can't be shocking to local officials or to reporters, especially like at Baltimore Sun. I saw the piece that they did because they've covered shootings and homicides on those same blocks. You know, Detective Sean Studer was killed or whatever you want to call it, you know, two blocks down. And it was all completely abandoned row homes. I think there were two livable row homes on that block. And so they've all seen this multiple times. It's just no one sounded the alarm. No one said anything. But God forbid President Trump tweets about it and, you know, he's a racist and how dare you shame our city. But it's like you guys all saw this. You saw this when you were there for the riot. You know, well, this is not a hidden secret.
Right, exactly. And last question, and I know you're probably pressed for time, but did the people that you speak to, were they at all concerned with you being a conservative, or was it more about getting the trash out there and what needed to be done?
No, yeah, they were concerned about getting the trash out. And even after the fact, I went back to tell them that the president had retweeted it and all that's going on and what he said. And they said, hallelujah, basically. Hopefully that'll get some attention and we can finally get this trash out of here. And they fully support what Trump said. So as long as they were happy, I was happy.
Do you know if the trash has been moved?
So I just found out maybe 3 hours ago, there is a private contractor from Reisterstown, Maryland, that has a team out on those two main blocks that I was on. He has a team out there now in gear, and they are removing large debris. Now, the residents themselves have yet to hear from anyone from the city.
Wow. Wow. Well, thank you, Kimberly Klasick, for joining us. And thank you for I'm sure that the residents of that area are grateful that that trash is being moved. So thank you for joining us.
Yeah. Thank you. I appreciate it.
Of course. So I want to get your thoughts on this, folks. You can text me 410-467-9225. You can also give me a call at 410-467-WBAL. As you just heard, an update from Kimberly Klasick, who reported on those conditions in this section of Baltimore, which was then retweeted. And there was a report done on Fox News. And next thing you know, we have the president talking about Baltimore. But at the start of all of this, at the very beginning, at the very base of all of this, are people living in a neighborhood where there are trash pileups? And I know I got a text message earlier from somebody who says that whenever they've had an issue with trash, they simply call 311 and the issue gets picked up. Well, that's great. We hope that's how it works. I hope that's how it works in every case. But what you're hearing here is that it doesn't work in every case. Think about this. These people have been asking the city to come deal with this since last year, since 2018. That's insane. In my neighborhood, if the trash is late a couple of hours, an hour, my neighbors start freaking out. If our school buses are late by 5 minutes and they are consistently late, which we did have an issue with that a couple of months ago, my neighbors start freaking out. Can you imagine if this kind of an issue in which you're asking the city to come pick up trash for a year and it doesn't happen? Folks, that's insane. But as we're hearing an update from Kimberly Klasick, that it looks like a private contractor from Reisterstown, Maryland, is dealing with that issue. So at its very core, this is about people who are relying on the city for particular services, trash pickup, and it wasn't getting done. Now it is getting done. If nothing else, that is a win. That is a plus. More in a moment.